Hello everyone and welcome to today's webinar, The Role of the Hatchery in Antibiotic-Free Production. My name is Gert de Lange and I'm Senior Poultry Specialist at Royal Pastry Farm. It is great to be speaking with all of you today. Before I start my presentation, I have a few housekeeping items to cover about this presentation and the Royal Pastry Farm webinar platform. There will be a few polls in which I invite you to give your opinion. You will have about 30 seconds to respond. Also, you are invited to ask questions through the chat function, and these will be answered as much as possible during the webinar in the chat. Shortly after the webinar, you will receive an email with a link to the webinar replay as well as the handout of the presentation. So let's get started. We are talking about antibiotics today, and before we do so, it's good to define what antibiotics are. Antibiotics are medicines which are used to prevent and treat bacterial infections, not only in animal production systems like in the poultry industry, but also in human health. And antibiotics are used in two different ways. The curative way is the way that we do when a flock of birds or even when human beings are sick, and antibiotics are prescribed to treat the disease. Then of course there is also the preventive use of antibiotics, which is to minimize the risk a flock of birds is getting sick, and as such it can also be seen as a growth promoter. There is a risk of using antibiotics, and that risk is antibiotic resistance in humans and in animals. And actually it does not mean that the humans or animals are getting resistant to antibiotics, but that the bacteria who are causing diseases are no longer responding to a treatment with antibiotics. And this, according to the World Health Organization, is one of the biggest threats to global health, food security and development today. And this problem can affect anyone of any age and in any country. And especially the misuse of antibiotics is accelerating the process of the development of antibiotic resistance. And that is why it's important that we pay attention to the restrictive use of antibiotics in livestock systems. Also, when antibiotic resistance is developing, people have to stay longer in hospitals, we need higher medical costs, and we get also an increased death rate. So there is a trend to go for antibiotic-free production, or even no antibiotics ever. And what does that actually mean? It means that we should try to stop the preventive use of antibiotics, but also to minimize the curative use of antibiotics. Well, I would like to make a statement. The use of antibiotics is to correct for imperfections. And if you agree with that statement, then there's only one thing to do, and that's to do the right thing. Let's not be imperfect, then we do not need antibiotics. So what can the hatchery do to minimize or to stop use antibiotics in animal production? Well, basically we have to understand that in the hatchery there is no direct need to use antibiotics. If they are applied in the hatchery, it is for the benefits for the chicks after they are being delivered to the farm, to prevent disease problems, to reduce first week mortality, or as a growth promoter. So basically when antibiotics are given in the hatchery, it is a preventive use of antibiotics. And the methods that antibiotics can be given in the hatchery is either by injection, intramuscular or subcutaneous, but also by in ovo vaccination, by in ovo application, I should actually say. Or sometimes the advice is given to the receiver of the DL chicks to start the chicks with antibiotics in the drinking water or even in the feed. Well, what can the hatchery do? Well, simply no longer applying antibiotics might become a disaster, because it might lead to problems in the farm, like increased first week mortality, for example by yolk sac infection or enphalitis. It can result in retarded growth or poor feed conversion ratios and even to condemnations in the processing plant. That brings me to a poll. I would like you to think for a little while about the following poll. In our hatchery, we do all we can do to minimize the use of antibiotics. Is it for you A, no, we just go for good hatch results, or probably it is B, yes, it has our great and continuous attention? Take a few seconds to think about it and to give your response. I think that should be roughly enough time. Maybe it's good to tell you now already that in the following slides you will see that going for good hatch results does not have to clash with actions to reduce the use of antibiotics. In fact, actually, these go often hand in hand. So what can the hatchery do? Well, what we should try to do is to keep the right balance. And in this case, it means we have to apply good management practices aiming to keep the disease resistance of the chicks that we produce at the highest level possible. And at the same time, we have to apply good hygiene practices to keep the disease pressure low. If the balance goes the other way and the disease pressure is going up and the disease resistance is going down, well, then we are actually making the mistakes that we might have to cover up with the use of antibiotics. So basically, try to keep the balance in the way you see it on this slide. That's what we have to do in the hatchery. So let's first talk about decreasing the disease pressure. Trying to keep the disease pressure low by good hygiene practices. Good hygiene practices basically has three aspects. It is to implement good biosecurity to keep pathogens, microorganisms as much as possible out of the hatchery. It is to avoid cross-contamination, to avoid that pathogens are being transported within the hatchery from one room to the other or from one flock to the other. And because we cannot really prevent bacteria to be present in the hatchery, to clean and disinfect as much as possible to keep the number, the disease pressure, as low as possible. So in the following slides, I will give a few examples of all these three aspects. Hatching eggs. Hatching eggs is the main source of contamination of your hatchery. And one of the special types of contamination could be because of vertical transmission. If a breeder flock is infected, for example, by Salmonella or Mycoplasma, or also viruses, several viruses also play a role, then we bring with hatching eggs the pathogens in the hatchery. And we call this vertical transmission. And one of the ways we can do to prevent this is to monitor the health status of the breeder flock. For example, by taking regular blood samples or to walk through the breeder house to take manure samples on your shoes or to collect fluff samples in the hatchery. And this kind of monitoring is helping you to detect breeder flocks that are a potential threat to your hatchery. Once we know that a flock is contaminated, we can decide either not to produce chicks from these flocks anymore, or we can then take extra actions during the production in the hatchery to avoid horizontal transmission. So that means one flock per hatcher and one hatchery room per hatch day to avoid that one infected breeder flock is contaminating chicks from other breeder flocks. Hatching eggs can also bring pathogens in another way. That, for example, when you set floor eggs or when you accept dirty eggs, or when you accept eggs with hairline cracks, or you have egg sweating taking place, that water is condensing on the shell of the eggs, that all helps to get pathogens either on the eggs or even worse, in the eggs. And the way you answer the questions on the slide determines also how many bacteria you are bringing into your hatchery. I would like to make another poll, and that's basically a statement. And the statement is, not setting floor eggs greatly contributes to lowering the need for the use of antibiotics. Do you agree, or maybe you do not agree, or probably you think, well, it might do something, but it's only limited. Take a few seconds to think about it and answer this poll. Meanwhile, I will give you an example from real practice. It's an integrated hatchery in Germany where they produce more than 100 million chicks per year. A few years ago, they decided to stop setting floor eggs and to stop setting dirty eggs, which roughly was 1% of the total eggs they set. By doing so, they increased hatchability by 0.8%. First week mortality reduced by 0.6%. And a very stunning figure is that the need to apply antibiotics and the use of antibiotics was reduced by 50%. So you can see that setting floor eggs, stopping to set floor eggs, can be a great help to reduce the need for antibiotics. Another aspect you can do to avoid that you carry in microorganisms in the eggs is to do a quality control. If you do quality control of the incoming eggs and you have too many dirty eggs or eggs with hairline cracks, then you can communicate with the breeder farm and to try to see what can be done to reduce these eggs coming to the hatchery, because those eggs are a risk for contamination. Then hatching egg disinfection. Disinfecting hatching eggs will help a lot to reduce the number of microorganisms you bring in the hatchery. But it does not make any sense to disinfect floor eggs or dirty eggs, because those eggs could already potentially be internally contaminated, and by disinfecting you cannot kill those microorganisms anymore. Hatching egg disinfection could be done in the breeder farm, but also in the hatchery. In the hatchery, of course, you have full control. When it happens in the breeder farm, you are not too sure if the protocols are properly followed. And that is also important to do the protocols properly. We used to disinfect hatching eggs commonly with formalin, but the use of formalin is greatly under pressure nowadays. And we see that more and more alternatives are being used, often based on liquids. When you change the method of hatching egg disinfection, it also means that you have to change the method of applying this disinfectant, and those two things go hand in hand. So it has to be fully controlled. And last but not least, I would like to mention that washing hatching eggs is a great risk. Once you wet an egg, bacteria can easily penetrate, and often with washing hatching eggs, you increase the problem rather than reducing it. An example about cross-contamination is the hygiene zones that we have in the hatchery, like an egg arrival room, a setter room, a kennelling and transfer room, a hatch room, and a chick handling and dispatch room. And what we try to achieve by these hygienic zones is an unidirectional flow of people, of material, of even of eggs and air, following the rule clean should never meet dirty. And by doing so, we can greatly reduce the risk for cross-contamination. A practical example of cross-contamination could be during transfer. When we transfer eggs from the setter to the hatcher, we should follow a few guidelines to minimize the risk of cross-contamination. We all know that the risk for bangers is bigger in old flocks than in younger flocks. So the advice would be to first transfer eggs of the young flocks. In this way, you keep your transfer room as clean as possible, and then when you are done with the young flocks, you continue with the old flocks. Also, during transfer, we have to deal with bangers. And those bangers can contaminate your transfer room greatly. So take those bangers out and dispose them off in a bucket with liquid disinfectant. Or even better, have a vacuum waste system whereby you can suck away the potential bangers. And when an egg is exploding, clean up immediately. Live egg detection rather than the normal kennelling or the old-fashioned kennelling based on only light is also helping to recognize potential rotten eggs and to take them out before they go to the hatcher. The vacuum heads that we use to lift the eggs from the setter tray to the hatcher baskets could be a big source of cross-contamination. So it's very important to clean and disinfect these vacuum heads at least once a day, at least before you use them again. Applying paper in the hatchery basket is not a direct need, but some hatcheries do. For example, for all the flocks, because in all the flocks is a bigger risk for bangers, and when you put paper in the hatchery basket, at least it will absorb that mess and kind of restrict the infection from just to a few baskets rather than through the entire hatchery. And another advantage could be, if you are not able to clean your hatchery basket properly because your washing machine is not working well and you want to keep your baskets as clean as possible for the next hatch, then using paper in the basket is a great help. Using formalin during the hatch to reduce the disease pressure. The bacteria bloom, it happens normally when the chicks are pipping, but it also helps to make nice and healthy looking yellow chicks. It is advised to use between 100 to 250 milliliters of formalin, 37-40% concentration. But what is more important than the amount is actually the surface area of the plate on which you apply the formalin. If I apply, for example, 200 milliliter formalin, you can ask yourself the question, in which case do I get the highest concentration? And obviously, this will be when you use plate A with a greater diameter. And the later on, in the next few slides, we will also see that formalin can do damage. So we should not have too high a concentration of formalin in the air. So the surface plate that we use to evaporate the formalin should be approximately 1,000 square centimeters and no more. Formalin is supposed to be placed just before the chicks start pipping, and it should be finished when the chicks are drying, because when the chicks are drying, the formalin becomes more aggressive to the chicks. In red, very important, there is a great risk of using formalin during the hatch, which I will explain later on. Also, the legislation is nowadays much more strict and is prohibiting the use of formalin in many countries. And another very negative aspect of formalin is the labor conditions. So the use of formalin during the hatch is under great pressure. Something about cross-contamination in relation to air. We apply pressure differences in the hatchery, not only because for the setters and the hatches to inhale the air easily and to exhale it easily, so for proper ventilation, but also to have an overpressure in the setter room, the cleanest room in the hatchery. By keeping an overpressure there, we minimize the inflow of pathogens from other more dirty rooms into the setter room. And in the fluff tunnel behind the hatches, we keep an underpressure so that the dirty air and the pathogens are not moving around through the hatchery. Finally, last part that I want to discuss about decreasing the disease pressure is about cleaning and disinfection. And of course, this is far more easy in single-stage hatcheries compared to multi-stage hatcheries, because a multi-stage setter is never getting empty, so very difficult to clean. A practical question is, how clean are your hatchery baskets? Maybe you cannot see it properly on the picture, but the hatchery basket floor bottom that you see on the right side is not clean. Visual not clean, but when you monitor and you use Rodac plates, you will even see lots of bacteria still growing on a hatchery basket. You can imagine when the hatchery basket is not clean and chicks are born in a dirty hatchery basket, that does not help in minimizing the use of antibiotics. This was about good hygiene practices to keep the disease pressure low. Next item is how to increase the disease resistance of the chicks that we produce. Well, basically we do that by applying good management practices, and in summary, that means we have to provide optimal incubation conditions for strong and vital day-old chicks, apply a good vaccination program to ensure a high level of immunity, and avoid stress factors for embryos and chicks like overheating, chilling, dehydration, or delayed feed access. And when we do these good management practices in a proper way, then greatly this contributes to the minimization of the use of antibiotics. When we talk about disease resistance, it's good to think for a little while what we mean by disease resistance. And we can recognize the first line of defense, the skin, the trachea in the intestinal wall. That is actually the barrier between outside the chick and inside the chick's body. And this first line of defense is playing a great role in preventing that pathogens enter into the chick's system. Then we have the so-called innate immune system, which you will see later on in the intestines, for example. It plays a very important role. And last but not least, we have antibodies that are working to specific diseases, specific pathogens. We have the so-called passive immunity, which is from the maternal origin. Mother hen is being vaccinated and passes on maternal antibodies to the dale chicks. And then, of course, we have the active immune system, whereby the chicks produce antibodies due to either contact by field viruses or field bacteria or by vaccination. When we look to the skin, what can we do in the hatchery to prevent that bacteria enter the chick through the skin? Well, navel is also skin as we see it. And we have to provide the best optimal incubation conditions such that the chick is being born with a well-closed navel. Then bacteria have less chance to enter into the chick. How can we do that? Well, very important to have proper embryo temperature control, not to incubate the eggs too warm, neither too cold. To have the proper egg weight loss such that the chick is able to close the navel over a normal size yolk sac. And also to realize that egg storage does not really contribute to a properly healed navel, but when you apply heat treatment of eggs during storage, you get a much better navel quality. So there are several things you can do in the hatchery to produce chicks with optimal, well-closed navel. Another issue is to avoid injuries by preventing the chicks are getting red hocks. Also the bottom of the hatchery basket. If the toes of the chicks are sticking through the bottom of the hatchery basket, and when you stack hatchery baskets, it could easily be that toes get damaged, and then again bacteria could enter through this open wound. Also, chick handling systems could potentially cause injuries to the chicks, so it's very important that these chick handling systems are animal friendly. Of course, when we do vaccinate chicks, we are creating an injury, basically. The needle is creating a hole in the skin. It's very important that you work with clean needles and with clean vaccine to avoid that you, during vaccination, infect the chicks with bacteria. Then the trachea. I'm coming back to the use of formalin during the hatch. We have seen that it helps to reduce the disease pressure, but here we're talking about the fact that it can also have a negative effect on the disease resistance. Because when you apply formalin, it could have a potential negative effect on the epithelial lining of the trachea. You see, the yellow chick looks very healthy, the chick on the right. But if you look to the microscopic picture of the trachea, you see that the lining there is heavily damaged. Whereas the white chick has not been treated with formalin, and it shows a very healthy picture, a very healthy trachea on the picture. So when the formalin is not used in a proper way, you could potentially damage the trachea of the chicks. And we also know from research that we see more respiratory problems when chicks are being treated with formalin in the hatcher. Even though it has a positive effect on the yolk sac infections, it could have a negative effect on the respiratory diseases. And there is a bigger risk for post-vaccination reaction when chicks are being treated with formalin. Also, there has been one paper I have seen during the preparation of this webinar whereby the FCR was negatively influenced by the use of formalin at the level of 23.5 ppm in the hatcher during the hatch. This brings me to a poll. Are you in your hatchery using any disinfectant during the hatch? Yes, formalin. Or B, yes we do, but we use something else. We do not use formalin. And in that case, would you please be so kind to add in the chat function what kind of chemical you use? And maybe your answer is C, no, we do not use any disinfectant during the hatch. I'm very curious to see what will be the answers that you are giving on this poll. I'll give you some little time to give the answer. And in the chat function, you will later on see the summary of the answers that are being given. I'm not yet finished with the first line of defense. A very important part of the first line of defense is the intestinal wall. The intestinal wall is covered by a mucus layer, and this mucus layer is preventing bacteria to enter into the chick's body. Then, of course, there is this epithelial lining, but what we also have to recognize in the guts of the day-old chicks is the bacteria, the gut flora. The good bacteria flora is preventing the bad bacteria to enter into the chick's body, and we can use this also in a commercial way by applying probiotics, the good kind of bacteria, during the hatch, and they are protecting that bad bacteria enter into the chick's body, and we call this competitive exclusion. Also, it is possible to provide prebiotics to the chicks, which is creating a healthy environment for the good bacteria. Then it's good to realize that the intestinal immune system is a very important part of the total immune system of the chick. It represents roughly 70% of the total. And this is mostly an innate immune system. That means that not really antibodies are playing a role here, but lots of other cells are fighting against bacteria who are trying to protrude into the body. Talking about antibodies, we do vaccinate the broiler breeders or the layer breeders to give them antibodies for themselves to not get sick, but also they pass on maternal antibodies in the yolk to the offspring. And it's very important that these maternal antibodies are not being used as a source of energy. They should be used by the chick for the function they are in the yolk, and that's to give immunity to the chicks. Then in the hatchery, but also in the farm, we provide vaccinations to produce antibodies, to let the chick produce antibodies by themselves. That is done by several organs in the chick. That's the thymus for the T cells, the bursa making the B cells, but also other glands like the Haderian gland behind the eye is being activated during spray vaccination to produce antibodies. A few things we can do in the hatchery to increase the disease resistance, again, is to think very carefully about incubation temperature and to avoid that we overheating the embryos, which means an eggshell temperature of more than 102 Fahrenheit. This is far more easy in single-stage incubation than in multi-stage incubation, because in single-stage incubation I can optimize the temperature set points for each phase of embryonic development. When embryos are being exposed to high temperatures, we are running the risk that yolk proteins are used for energy, and it could even be that maternal antibodies then will be used for energy rather than for immunity. High embryo temperatures also have a negative effect on the size of the thymus and the bursa, and as we have seen in a slide before, the thymus and the bursa are playing a role in the production of antibodies. And, as mentioned already before, high embryo temperatures is not positive for the navel quality. So incubation temperature should be very closely under control if we want to increase the disease resistance of the chicks. Feed access. We should avoid the chicks are getting delayed feed access. The sooner the chicks get feed, the better it is. And how can we achieve that? Well, First of all actions that we take to reduce the hatch window and to pull the chicks in time greatly helps in minimizing the time that the chicks are without feed. Once we pull the chicks at the correct time and we have a smooth processing and a timely delivery to the farm, the chicks are able to eat as quickly as possible after hatch. But if for one reason or the other that is not possible, a good option would be to provide feed in the hatcher already during the hatch, as soon as the chicks hatch. When feed is available and the chicks have the option to eat, then they have access to early feeding, which is important because feed stimulates the development of the intestines, and this goes hand in hand with the intestinal immunity development. When chicks are starting to eat early, it also helps in the yolk sac resorption. And in the yolk sac, we have the maternal antibodies. So the sooner the chicks have those maternal antibodies in their bloodstream, the better it is for their immunity. And it also helps with the microbial colonization. It avoids also that maternal antibodies are used for energy. So early feed access is important. Another part to talk about is chick comfort. We have to avoid that the chicks are getting any kind of stress. So we should avoid the chicks are getting overheated or chilled. When chicks are overheated, they start panting, and because they pant, they evaporate water at a faster rate from their body, and this leads to dehydration, and that is reducing their resistance against diseases. And stress on the whole is preventing the immune system from functioning properly. So how do we know that our chicks are comfortable? Well, how do we know that we're not overheating or chilling them? Of course, we could measure their body temperature, as you see on one of the pictures below the slide. If we have a body temperature between 103 and 105 Fahrenheit, we can say the chicks are comfortable. But we can also use more practical skills. When you feel the feet of the chick on your hand and you feel the feet of the chick are cold, you can rest assured that chick's body temperature is below optimal. And when chicks are huddling, like you see in the blue crates, that's a sign that the chicks are not feeling comfortable. They're looking for social warmth because they are chilled. And when chicks have their beaks open, as a sign of panting, you know the chicks are overheated. So those skills of recognizing chick comfort are very important for people working in a hatchery. A nice example from practice is spray vaccination. When we spray vaccinated chicks, they get wet. And when chicks are getting wet, they are more prone to chilling. So you might be tempted to reduce the droplet size to below 100 micrometers by making a fine mist. But when you make a very fine mist, your chicks are getting less wet, of course, but those small droplets are also inhaled deeply into the chick's respiratory tract, and it can cause a post-vaccination reaction. So we have to vaccinate the chicks with coarse droplets, making them wet. And those chicks are more prone to chilling. If you put the chicks in the chick dispatch room of a proper temperature of, let's say, 25 centigrades, it is not a guarantee that those chicks, those wet chicks, will be comfortable. Especially when there is airflow, those chicks might be chilled. So it is probably better to let the chicks first dry in a little bit a warmer room with less airflow before you move them to the chick dispatch room. The chicks have to be moved from the hatchery to the farm. So they deserve first-class transport and a warm welcome. And it's not just temperature control that we have to do during this transport, but also to consider the airflow, because those two together, they determine chick comfort. And when the chicks arrive in the house, it is not sufficient to only have a proper room temperature. It's also very, very important that the floor temperature on which the chicks are living is approximately 28 till 30 centigrades. You can imagine when chicks are being housed on a cold floor, they lose energy through their legs and this will drop their body temperature. So floor temperature is probably even more important than the temperature of the air in the house itself. And of course, very important is that the water is fresh and clean and that feed is available for the chicks to eat. So I have come to the end of this webinar. And I would like to summarize what can the hatchery do to minimize the use of antibiotics. Well, looking to the balance, you have to keep the disease resistance of the chicks as high as possible by good management practices, to keep the disease pressure as low as possible by good hygiene practices, and you have to think very strongly, what is the weakest link in my hatchery that is not helping me to reduce the need to apply antibiotics? And if you know which link that is, then you have to simply fix it. Thank you very much for watching to this webinar. As said before, you will receive a mail shortly after the end of this webinar with the webinar replay and the handout. And please also visit the knowledge section at our website. Thank you very much and see you at our next webinar.
Royal Pastry Farm, for the highest number of best quality chicks.